Well, they didn't make it a holiday, and there is a raging pandemic out there. Considering all that, why are you voting? Hey, it's me, Elliot. You know, most analysts predict a record voter turnout for November's presidential election, but despite this forecast, there are still those who say they're planning not to vote, insisting that my vote doesn't count, I don't have the time, or trying to make the case that in this election cycle, there are no good options. Christiane Klein is not one of them. Klein, a former television news anchor and correspondent for ABC News, is also a global ambassador for HealthCorps, a nonprofit created by TV's Dr. Oz. She's also an author. Her most recent publication released this past April is a children's book co-authored with her mom, licensed family therapist Helen Van Sant Klein. It's called Anna, the Germ That Came to Visit. It's a story designed to give children the tools they need to deal with the COVID-19 pandemic.
I'm sitting here washing my hands for the 15th time. I miss my friends, but mommy reminds me
Christiane Klein joins us now from her home somewhere in the Western Tier. Christiane, how are you?
I'm great. Thank you so much for that lovely introduction, Elliot. Nice to see you again.
Yeah, nice to see you too. Thank you so much. Now, I've got to ask you, we're listening to that companion song that had to go with the book. Was that you singing?
It was not. And I love that you asked that question because very few people know that I also sing. But it was written based off of the book. It's called Hey Germ, Go Away. And it was written by Tony Sattel and performed by Allison Wedding. And they're actually based over in Florida. And I love that song. It's actually on our website as well, thegermbook.com. We've got a 20-second hand washing version. So kids know exactly 20 seconds and parents can play that for them because sometimes when you have a little one, that can be very tricky to meet those CDC guidelines. So that was just a happy accident. They were inspired by the book and wrote this song to go with it. And there's been a lot of really, in a difficult time, beautiful moments that have come out of this difficult time of people working together and trying to help each other. And the book, as you mentioned, was one of them. And then the song. And we've really had had a lot of different moments from teachers around the country and grandparents and parents who are using this as companion pieces in their Zoom classes and reading it to their grandchildren to help them through the pandemic and that mental toll that we're seeing from little kids.
Absolutely, sure. It's absolutely perfect. But now, take me on a timeline here. The pandemic started late February, early March. You released this in April. How'd you get this out so quick?
A lot of help. A lot of help. It was something that hit me. I always describe it as a bolt of lightning because, as you know, I'm a writer, I'm a journalist, and I have a 2-year-old little girl. And could not figure out how we were going to explain to her what was going on in the world, why she couldn't see her grandparents right now, why she couldn't see her cousins, why we couldn't go to the park, why everything changed in a heartbeat. And I knew, because I have other friends that are parents of young ones, that they were all dealing with the same thing. And I started looking for a book that would cover any portion of this to deal with the emotional toll of the pandemic. And there wasn't anything because of course it was so new. So I said, I have to write this. And I wrote the first draft and called my mother, who's a marriage and family therapist. And I said, this is what I wrote, but I want you to help me weave in therapeutic tools so that this story is helping people on a much larger scale rather than just a story of Anna. And everything we chose in it had purpose. So even the title, Anna and the Germ That Came to Visit, visit is a finite period of time.
Sure.
I really wanted to make sure that not only we're giving them these tools and parents' tools to help take more off of their plate to deal with the loss and the boredom and the sadness and the fear and all those things that we're all dealing with, but that there also was hope at the end.
Sure.
So they're at the end of the book, the germ goes away, but they know that based on everything they've gone through, if it ever comes back, they'll be able to get through it again together. And that message of hope and resilience was so, so important because it's a very difficult time for a lot of people, and it still is, and we just don't know how long we're going to be dealing with these
sure.
waves,
right.
you know, these waves of shutting things down again and feeling like we're right back where we started. It's been a very tricky and difficult time, but to be able to help people has been really lovely.
Sure. It's a remarkable achievement. And thank you for doing that. I think, and I say that for a lot of parents who need that guidance so very badly. So thank you. Talk to me about your voting experience. We talked a little bit about this before, and from what I understand, you came to the idea of that obligation of voting much earlier than many of us did you not?
I did. So it's very interesting. I look back on this, and you actually prompted me to look back on this experience because it's so ingrained in my life. You don't necessarily think of it until someone asks you. And I grew up in a household where there was one Democrat and one Republican. Both my parents were from opposite political parties. And I don't remember there ever being arguments about their political beliefs, but I do remember that every time that there would be a new election cycle, my mother would get very, very protective and say, "Do not tell me how to vote. Don't tell me how to vote. Don't argue with me. Don't do." And it became this very sacred experience in a way that she was. And I started volunteering campaigns teenager before I was old enough to vote. And I remember wanting to be 18 so badly so that I could register. And the first thing I did on my birthday when I turned 18 was fill out my form, my paperwork to be able to register to vote. And part of that was I turned 18 in an election year, so I couldn't wait. It was like, you know, gift from the heavens. but part of it, I really think, was because I recognized that there was, this is all internal, you don't realize at the time, but that there was something special about it and something to be protected and something that other people couldn't tell you what to do. Mm-hmm. And so as an 18-year-old and looking back at this and not really rebellious teenager, I knew I could vote however I wanted. You know, this was my little version of rebellion. And at different times through my life, I would vote a certain way and be like, well, I'm canceling out my dad's vote, or I'm canceling out my mom's vote. You know, those things that teenagers think. But it was one of those things where in the voting booth, and I think this is just so interesting and fundamental to our democracy, everyone is equal, or at least is supposed to be. Mm-hmm. So my vote counts as much as yours. My vote counts as my dad's or my mom's or Donald Trump or Joe Biden or Elon Musk or Bill Gates or you know, your grocer or your firefighter or your favorite police officer, whoever it is in your community, that counts the same. There is nothing that is as equalizing on its face in this world as your vote.
Mm-hmm.
One vote, one person.
Absolutely.
And that to me is just so beautiful and powerful. And if people thought about it that way, I mean, if you look at just the numbers alone to 2020, the amount of new voters that couldn't vote in 2016 is more than 15 million people. Mm-hmm. That is an enormous voting block and has so much power alone. So if you had everybody who couldn't vote the last time vote this time, that's 15 extra million people.
Sure.
That changes the election in untold ways. People wouldn't have any clue because those are first time voters.
Mm-hmm.
And that to me is power. When we vote in mass, when we look at it that way, and when you see how few people normally vote, especially in some of these local elections. We had election for mayor a few years ago here in Las Vegas. 9% of people showed up to vote.
Wow.
Nine.
Really?
And it's skewed the age ranges from the average age of people who live here are in the 30s mm-hmm. in Las Vegas.
Mm-hmm.
The median age for voting in that election was 68 years old. That is a tremendous difference.
That is something.
So if people, if everyone voted, it would change everything about this
yeah.
country now, and everything about your community.
Absolutely. And that's what we're hoping. We're hoping that will take hold to as many people as possible out there before November 3rd. You mentioned your first election. What was your first election?
Mm-hmm.
Who was running? Do you remember?
I do. I will tell you. It was a Clinton election. It was the second one.
Uh-huh.
So yes, it was a presidential election, 1996. And I remember just not being able to wait to get involved. And there because I'm born in March, I was able to also vote in the primary. Mm-hmm. So there was a lot of different things. I got to vote a couple different ways and a couple different times that year. And to me, what was really interesting, I really wanted that experience of going in person and voting. Not any time since, because as you know, working in news, you never know if you're going to have breaking news. So I voted in tea for most of the other times. But that first time, I wanted to physically go to the polls. And I was also lucky enough that down the street, we had a long, long, long time polling house in our neighborhood that would every single election would be our polling place on the same street. So it was really this momentous experience and occasion of walking down the street to a place that I would walk home from school every day and being able to then cast my first vote in an election there. And I remember it. And I remember having, you know, the sticker and being so proud of the sticker. I'm still very proud of the sticker. My daughter steals it now. You can't keep a sticker away from a 2-year-old.
No, you can't.
but it's one of those things where there's a sense of pride that goes along with it, as silly as that is. And I know I'm not the only one to feel that way because I've had this conversation multiple times with people.
Well, Christiane Klein, thank you so very much for your thoughts here and your stories. Just made all the difference in the world. Best of luck to you and your family going forward. And again, continued success with the book, Anna and the Germ.
Thank you, Ellie.
Remember, November 3rd is not your first chance to vote. In many ways, it's your last chance to vote. That's why I'm leaving links in the comments below to help you cast your vote conveniently and safely. Remember to like us on Facebook at Now with Elliot Francis, then subscribe to our YouTube channel, then go vote in person, by mail if you have to, vote early if you can, but by all means, go vote.